Prayer works. Prayer changes things. I believe in the power of prayer. But very seldom do Christians pray. Until the boat's about halfway down. I will tell you this, what prayer and praying in the Holy Ghost was designed to do was to keep the enemies from getting in the camp so you would never have to do hand-to-hand combat. The spiritual armor was given to you in case the enemy came in, not when.
Yes, that's right.
See, they had little guys perched on the city wall that had a little spear, and they would throw that spear about 500 feet and kill them. In hopes that they would kill enough of them that they wouldn't want to come in. But if they did get in, then the armor, it seems the church has got it backwards. We focus on the armor, always in some battle with the devil. Yes, because you didn't pray, you didn't throw your spear. Amen, Pastor. Thank you for loving us. And then when you pray and pray in the Holy Ghost, you access the plan and mind of God, and He will give you what the enemy's going to do.
Yeah.
It's not God's desire that the enemy come in and beat you half to death. And
right.
Say, oh, I didn't think about that, David. Hang on. Grab your sword.
Right. Come on.
See, he is the God, one of his redemptive names, or the God who sees ahead and provided before there was ever a need. That must mean that he has a plan before all hell broke loose in your life.
Amen. Yeah.
A lot of times it can be avoided.
Amen.
Here's what I had to learn over the years about fighting the devil. 99% of it is my unrenewed mind and my own undisciplined flesh. The things I say, my attitudes, my emotions, the way I act, and I blame the devil in order. But really, it's all me. You know, years ago, I used to get on a bus. I'd go all over the country running from the law, running from people. And then I heard a man say this, and he said, no matter how far you run, wherever you go, there you are. I said, no wonder that I had the same problems in Arizona as I did in Texas, as I did in California, as I did in Arkansas. I was the common denominator of all those places. Figure that out. So we're going to continue, and if we want revival, how many of you really want revival? Every revival, you can follow the Old Testament, and you can follow the history of revival. Every revival starts with people who have who answer the call to pray. God will not move, or we could say like this, He will not move in this earth until He is legally invited by the body of Christ.
Amen.
Amen.
God can't just do whatever He wants to do. I hope you've understood that coming to church here.
Yes.
Well, God can do whatever He wants. No, He can't. The book of Psalms says that He has exalted His word above His name. What does that mean? Although His name is God, He has the right to do anything He wants. He wrapped Himself in the confines of the word of God. That way, He says, that when this happens, you will know it's me.
Amen.
Although He could do anything He wants, He's chosen to limit Himself to whatever's laid out in the Word of God. Amen?
Amen.
That's good, so we could understand God. For a long time, the religious world, the church world, had it ingrained in us that we're not supposed to understand God.
Right.
How many of you ever heard growing up in church, you're not supposed to question God?
Yeah.
Huh? That's a big fat lie.
Amen.
The book of James says, if you don't know, ask me.
That's Amen. Right.
And then in Isaiah, He came to His people and He said, come, let us reason together. In other words, He's saying, I got the answers, you don't. But all prayer is a form of asking God to access His wisdom and eternal riches. Remember what I taught you here. The love of God is unconditional, but the promises of God are conditional. To access His heart, His mind, and the truth of God and the riches of His kingdom, it takes effort on your part.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You know why a lot of people never grow beyond their salvation experience? Because that's where they stop. They don't pray. They don't read books. They don't dig into the Word of God. You know, unless you go to church here, going to church every Sunday necessarily won't cause you to grow. Amen. But the Bible says, desire in 1 Peter 2:2 to desire the sincere milk of the Word, which thereby you may grow.
Yeah.
See, you want to grow up and be a strong Christian, you got to get in the milk and the meat of the Word. Amen? All right, 2 Corinthians chapter 10. That was just a little warm-up session for you. Not nothing you haven't heard. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. How many of you think our worship's getting better and better here?
Amen.
See, one day you guys are going to lose your inhibitions and we're just going to cut loose in here.
Amen.
2 Corinthians chapter 10. One guy brought me up in the ministry. He said, "Look here, honey, I didn't stop dancing when I got saved. I just changed partners." You hear me?
Amen.
2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 3. We're going to continue on blood covenant. Have you enjoyed what you've heard so far?
Yes. Amen.
Remember, let me read this and then we'll go over it. 2 Corinthians chapter 10 is a very familiar passage of Scripture. It says, "Though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh." All of you need to circle that, underline it, highlight it. "For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh." The problems at your job, the problems at your home, the problems in this church will not be solved by the flesh.
Amen.
Amen.
Let's say that again.
That is so good.
Amen. The problems on your job, the problems in your home, the problems in your church will not be solved by fleshly things. Do you understand?
Yes.
That's why we don't vote here, because I don't need somebody getting mad at me and somebody with 20 members in the family telling me how we're going to run the church. No, the Holy Spirit runs this church.
Amen.
You understand? I don't need a few people that give a lot of money telling the rest of us what to do.
Amen.
If God has to, He'll bring in 50 people to make up that amount they took with them when I prayed them out of here.
Amen.
Amen. See, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. In other words, it says, although we walk in the flesh, we don't war after the flesh. Man, it takes a long time to learn this. But in our bodies, listen, if we fight in our churches, Brother Paul said, the reason you fight and quarrel among you is because you're riddled and you're full of pride.
Yeah. Amen.
Well, we had a church split. Oh, well, then your church was full of pride. Oh, no, we weren't full of pride. We're hungry. No, the Bible says you were full of pride.
That's right.
You were full of strife and you were full of arrogance. Listen, if we can figure this out, that although we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. Look at that cute little somebody sitting next to you. Can you look that way, Shirley? Listen, they are not your problem.
Amen.
Understand this. Listen, everybody look at that person next to you, okay? Let's get this down. They are not your problem, though you walk in the flesh.
It's okay to disagree with the pastor.
Yeah. He is great.
Are you okay? Alright. Though you walk in the flesh, you do not war after the flesh. You know what? You can't. Now listen, man. If you go into some kind of program will help you stop doing drugs and alcohol, man, do it.
Yeah.
Do you understand? But if it's not Bible-based, spirit-filled, it won't do you much good, because it's a fight of willpower and behavior modification. That's why you got to get up every week and say, "Hi, I'm David. I'm a so-and-so."
Yeah.
My wife said amen. But listen, you cannot fight flesh with flesh. It's impossible. And let me tell you this. This will help you, okay, in your Christian life. I've had to learn a lot of things the hard way over the years, okay? Anger will not curb anger.
Amen.
Well, you don't know how so-and-so, how they treat me. Well, when you respond the same way, guess what? Anger plus anger equals anger.
Yes. Amen.
The Bible says that a soft answer turns away wrath.
Amen.
That's why He said, be doers of the word, not hearers. Oh, Pastor, that's good. Pastor, that's good. And then you get home and you blow up at each other.
Right.
Oh, that's good. That's good. That's good. No, it's good if you listen and you do it. That's when it's good.
Right.
Otherwise, it's just me wasting my time. So He says, though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. People and circumstances are not your problem.
Amen.
You cannot fix anybody else, so stop trying.
Amen.
Ooh, that'll take a lot of effort out of somebody. Yeah, this is my fourth pastor, man. It took me about 2.5 to figure out I can't fix none of you. How about wore myself out trying to fix everybody and everything and every problem. And finally I realized, wait a minute, all I'm to do is give you the tools. How you build your house is up to you. I give you the tools of the blueprint. Man, I got tired trying to help everybody build their house.
Yeah, that's right.
He said, though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. Now we'll read verse 4 and 5. A good little introduction, right? And he says this, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. Let me tell you this. Understand this. There is a type of warfare going on.
Yes.
You understand? But please, please, the Bible says there is spiritual wickedness in heavenly places. Do you understand that?
Yeah.
That there is a spiritual realm that directly influences our natural realm, and our natural realm directly influences the spiritual realm.
Amen. Amen.
Here's what it says about faith in Hebrews 11:1. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. It's like this. Faith in the Word of God, believing and acting, speaking the Word of God, is a hand that reaches into the unseen realm and pulls into the seen realm. Do you understand? And in fear, grumbling, complaining, anger, hatred, strife, jealousy, are the things that pull from the earth realm and place in the natural realm bait for the hordes of hell to swarm around.
Wow. Okay. Wow, that's so good. That's good. Wow.
So when we figure out, that's why Job said in Job 3:25, this thing that I greatly feared has come upon me. It's a clue that those kind of things draw satanic activity.
Right, yeah. Right.
See, right, there is a spiritual warfare, but please, don't go buy the books like they did in the 80s and 90s and get silly about spiritual warfare, okay?
Amen. Amen. I won't.
Understand this. The Bible teaches this, that Satan is a defeated foe. Amen. You understand?
Amen.
And here's what Jesus said. Listen, we are not the warring church like you have been taught.
That's right.
We are not the warring church. Some of them, I heard the teaching about principalities and spiritual wickedness in high places. You wouldn't think folks would do this, but they do. You wouldn't think people would buy a little bottle of spring water for $40 trying to get healed off of TV, but they do.
Amen.
And so they would get around and fly in airplanes, and they would speak to the powers and the atmospheric things that dwelt in there. That's stupid. Don't do that. Now, we are an army, okay? There is a spiritual warfare, but listen, here is what we are. Since our general and the angels conquered and defeated Satan, do you understand? He has no power, no authority, no ability except what you give him.
Praise God. Amen.
Only what you allow him to have. That's all he's got. He rises up a rebellion. He spreads lies. We buy it hook, line, and sinker. If the church could ever understand, this is what I hate Christians doing. Have you seen about that gay marriage? What are we going to do? Shut up. If you would have took your rightful place in the beginning, these things wouldn't be an issue. But since you don't know what to do, let me clue you in. Go into that place and preach the gospel to every creature there.
Amen.
We're trying to damn them to hell and bring them to the foot of the cross.
Amen.
That's what you do. What are we going to do? We're going to preach. We're going to love. We're going to give. We're going to help. That's what we're going to do.
Amen.
Jesus said this. He said this. Occupy until I come. See, we are an occupying army.
Amen.
I'll spend all our time and energy trying to fight this, and I'm fighting this, I'm fighting that, I'm fighting that. Really, when you get into proper perspective, we'll get deeper into this covenant thing. We are an occupational army. Satan has already been defeated at the cross when Jesus suffered hell for 3 days and 3 nights and rose victorious. Man, I'm about to get excited.
Amen.
He poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost in the upper room, and he made men, mere men, what he was. He gave them what he was to Satan. And he told the devil, he said, sit down, Waldo. And it says he stripped, really, if you read it and understand the Hebrew, what he did is he stripped the devil down naked, cut off his thumbs and his big toes, chained him to a wagon, threw everything that he owned in there, shamed him publicly. Then he took the keys to hell, death, and the grave, and he gave them to mankind. Isn't that good? He gave them to
mankind.
Oh, that's good. And we have spent our energy trying to fight a defeated foe. It has been ratified in blood. The terms of the treaty, okay? And so what Satan does, I've told you all this before, he has two weapons, deception rooted in fear. And when he starts a rebel uprising, then this occupational army does what Jesus did and says, sit down, Waldo.
Amen.
I don't have time for you to wreck my family, my city, or anything else I love. Do you understand?
Amen, that's what's up.
You have no power here. And in fact, if we ever figure out who we are in the church, we could change the world.
That's right. Amen.
Jesus said, you are the light set on a hill. Well, how come we're not shining anywhere but in these walls most of the time? Man, we have revivals and we're trying to get saved folks saved. Saved folks don't need saved.
That's right.
I like good preaching. Do you understand? But man, you need to get out there where they are. With
that's
the
right.
Truth.
Amen.
You can still tell what a preacher's work, and he still preach
that's
out
true.
There like he does in here. You can tell the worth of them.
Yes, yes.
Are we in it for the money, the fame, the prestige, the power, the position, or we have to be
people?
We find out to be hurt. So he says that for though the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, in other words. Now let me finish this. But mighty through God. Everybody say through God.
Through God.
There's covenant talk right there. Remember they exchanged
that's
weapons
right.
When they
Amen.
Became covenant brothers and sisters.
That's right.
David Livingston, that evangelized the continent of Africa, he used to carry a big sword of this great, or great, a big spear of this great warlord from one of the African tribes. And everywhere David Livingston went, they said, he's in covenant with Big Boy. Don't mess with him. If you mess with Dr. Livingston, you will pay for it. Leave him alone. You see that spear he carries? Now listen, when we accept Jesus as our Savior, when we are born again, when we get filled with the power of the Holy Spirit, here is what happens. We exchange our fleshly natural weapons for the weapons of His warfare, our natural weapons for His spiritual weapons. Do you understand?
Amen.
We trade our hatred for His love.
Amen.
Come on.
Okay, that's hard to understand, isn't it? See, you don't answer hate with hate. All that does is breed hate.
That's it. That's
we exchange our jealousy and mistrust for His ever-trusting heart.
Yes,
right. We trade our revenge and our I'm going to get you for that attitude to love takes no account of the wrong done to it.
Amen.
You see, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. They don't even make sense to the natural mind.
Right, right. Right.
Here is how the human being act. You do me wrong, treat me wrong, I'm going to pull away from you and I'm going to keep you out of my life. But the nature of God says the more you try to run from me, the more I'm going to come and get you. And I'm going to love you until we break through this thing and figure it out. That's the weapons of our warfare. Then we've been given prayer. I'm telling you, if we could ever get the church to pray, we could change. It took one old lady named Madeline O'Hare to get prayer out of school. One ugly, mean-hearted old lady to take prayer out of school.
Amen.
And all the Christians walking around saying, you know, prayer changes things, brother. All we can do is pray. No, we understood how to access the power that was available to us.
Amen.
Right, right.
Well, you see the shambles our country's in? Yeah, because the shambles that our churches are in.
Yes.
Amen.
Here is how it works in the spirit realm, okay? We're going to learn a little bit today. Whatever happens to God's people, then it's farmed out to the world. In Romans 1:16, this principle said that he preached salvation to the Jews and then unto the Greek. In other words, if the church is in a bad shape, the world will be in bad shape.
Amen.
See, when we experience revival and the truth of the word in church, it affects whole cities. I don't have time to get into all of them, but read about some of them, man. There were police stations that had nothing to do for months on end. Why? Revival hit a little community bars and changed the city.
That's right. That's right.
Bars closed down and strip clubs and all the houses of ill repute shut down. Why? Because one church had a move of God that changed them.
Amen.
Amen.
because it changed them, they changed the city.
Amen.
I'll tell you this. If we as a people can sit in four walls and suck up our blessings, our prosperity, and our healing, and never once go to the world, we have not experienced the true God of the Bible. When a body experiences the true God of the Bible, the true Holy Spirit, you can't sit still, you're not satisfied, and four walls cannot hold you.
Amen.
Why? Because the apostle said, it's the love of God that constrains me or that pushes me forward. In other words, I want to stay here. Here it's comfortable. Here I'm a good Christian boy. And the love of God has two hands on my back pushing me to the world. That's how it's supposed to work. And so, but there are mighty through God for the pulling down of strongholds. I want to get into all that. But I got good news and I got bad news. The weapons of your warfare are carnal. What does that mean? The good news about it is, since you can't do anything about it, your job is to rest and allow God to work it out.
Amen. Yes. Amen.
No one which battles. Amen.
The bad news about it is that those of you who think you have control of your life, you do. But here's the bad thing. Here's the bad thing about the weapons of your warfare not being carnal. You are not smart enough. You are not fast enough. And you do not have enough money to run your own life properly without the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
I think about this quite a bit. A lot of people that I knew, they was their own man. Nobody tell me what to do. We're opening door three. Yeah. I'm an old man. Nobody tell me what to do. And man, I was that dude. Here we go. Now everybody tells you what to do when you're not connected to the Holy Spirit. You are ran by every stupid demon in hell.
Oh,
you run from liquor store to dope house, from woman to woman, man to man.
Preach
and when you're serving God, you do only that which the Spirit of God desires. You don't fall for some slick-talking, bald-headed boy to run you off. You don't fall for some pretty little wiggle and get yourself in trouble. You ain't chasing dope and alcohol. You're serving God, and therein lies the power of choice.
True freedom. Yeah. True freedom. Amen.
True freedom says no
not false
to everything
freedom.
Of God.
Amen.
That's when you
Amen.
Know you access the power of God.
That's right.
That's what true holy living and conforming to the Word is. Not that I'm afraid I'm going to go to hell, but I don't want to mess with that stuff. I've done that before.
Right.
In fact, I've had all that I want.
Amen. Amen.
My God, I've had all that.
Amen.
Go to Mark 16. We'll spend a lot of time there. We're getting down to the weapon now. It'll make sense in a minute, okay? Mark 16. Today, if you would like, you may be filled with the Holy Spirit before you leave today. You can experience true healing in your body, in your mind, in your emotions, your family, whatever. All you got to do is ask. Mark chapter 16, where it says about the baptism of the Holy Ghost, that all you got to do is ask. And old Pentecost, man, it's crazy. They get you around the altar and tell you to say glory, say Jesus. One guy hang on, one guy let loose. I just say Jesus real fast, and then say hallelujah real fast. But really, the biblical pattern said just ask.
Amen.
Is that if you, being a natural person, wouldn't give your son a scorpion if he asked for an egg, how much more will your Father give you the Holy Spirit to them that ask?
That's right.
See, God's really easy. Religion has made God hard. If I give enough, if I pray enough, if I do enough, if I act good enough, God will do something for me. And if I don't, I'm out of luck. No, all God says is ask me.
That's right.
All I got to do is ask me.
That's right.
I was talking to somebody at work the other day, and I said, here's the thing, the God of the Bible versus the God you've been taught. God doesn't ask for perfection, he asks for sincerity.
That's right.
All God asks for is you do your best, and he'll do the rest.
That's right.
Just do your best. That's the beauty of covenant, where you're weak. Remember Paul said, where I'm weak, he is strong. All he says is do your best. Even if the world says you're a hopeless failure, you and I know where we're at. Don't worry
that's
about
that. Right.
He said, they got more problems than you anyway.
Right.
You can only put so many layers of pain on a flaw before it starts to show through anyway, honey. I promise you.
That's right.
That's why I get nervous if you see a woman that has a lot of makeup caked on by a run when it comes out. See, she's not trying to look pretty. She's hiding something. Get out of there. Mark chapter 16.
Oh, Lord.
Verse 17. Look what it says. Now, how do you know, Pastor? I spent a lot of time in dark bar rooms. I swear they had body doubles by the time. Okay, Mark 16, 17, all right? Covenant. Talking about his weapons versus your weapons, all right? Some of you, you know, we've been taught in a lot of the churches that we got to strive to enter into heaven. Those of you who have been around long enough know that we don't strive to enter into heaven, amen? That thinking should be washed away from you. In fact, the book of Hebrews says the only thing that we as new covenant creatures strive for, now listen, is to enter into God's rest.
Yes.
The only thing I'm ever trying to do is rest.
That's so cool.
Religion is a hard taskmaster.
Right.
You are constantly working on this, I'm fixing that, I'm doing that, I'm involved in this. And God said, just rest, dude.
Amen.
Just rest. If you could ever learn to rest, you got it.
Amen.
Rest and be guilt-free. You've got the New Testament in a nutshell. That's all God wants for you.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Mark 16, 17 says this. And these signs shall follow them that believe. And I'm just going to stop right here. Because you know, if I go on, we won't never get off that verse. So he says, in my name will they cast out devils. Let me tell you this about covenant. In covenant, when they came together... you know, if I told them, remember I told you they came together on weakness. If there was a farmer and warriors got together, the farmers got with the warriors because they were tired of getting beat up, right?
Yeah.
And the warriors got with the farmers because they were tired of beating everybody up and then going to bed hungry. So he said, you need us, we need you, let's come together. So here's what you got to understand. When you became Christian, right? You took the name of Jesus, the family name, upon yourself. You took the title of Christian, Christ-like, or like the Anointed One.
Amen.
Amen. You took that upon yourself. And so here's what happens. Luke 10, 19 says this. He said, behold, I give you. That's you. Now, how many of you have been fighting with the devil? Huh? Struggling with the devil. Well, this will help you. Okay, he said, behold, I give you, that's you, and you, authority, that word, or I give you power. That's a Greek word, exousia, which means authority. He says, listen, I have given you the authority. Remember Sam Waldo. He said, I've given you the authority to trample over serpent, scorpion, over all of the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means harm you.
Amen.
Amen.
That'll make you run and shout, man. See, you've been lied to by the churches. It's not big old devil beating you up. And pray to God, I learned something from this. Now, the words of Red say this, that you have the authority over the devil.
Amen.
And that nothing shall by any means harm you. What does that mean? By covenant right, you have been given the power of attorney in the universe to sit over the affairs of God.
Amen.
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 Praise God.
Let me tell you that again. Jesus said, in my name you'll cast out devils. In other us.
Come on.
And then he said, I've given you the authority. In other words, I trust my creation enough. 2 Corinthians 3 says that we are co-laborers together with God.
Yes.
That means we work together. We're partners, man.
Yes.
Amen.
He needs me and I need him.
And
he
needs
me as much as I need
him. Yes, he does.
And when you start understanding how the spirit realm works, God does not desire to live without you.
Amen.
And there is a part of his plan that includes only you, and only you can fulfill that part of his destiny.
Yes.
And so he said, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to give you my name. I'm giving you power of attorney. He said, look here, mankind, the world belongs to you. Do with it what you will, but be careful.
Yes.
That first bite is a doozy. He said, be careful. Just listen to me. He warned Adam and Eve in the garden. If you read the literal Hebrew, he gave them an indication when he said subdue. It's an indication that there is a rebel in the universe coming to steal from you what I've given you. Be careful. And he said, now is the new covenant creation. I filled you with the very thing that makes me me. And he said, in the spirit realm, there is no difference between us. Why? We entered into a blood covenant. Our blood has mingled together. The Bible says this, the life of the body is in the blood.
Yes.
Amen.
The life of the body of Christ resides in knowing what his blood did. Well, it washed away sin, yeah, but it also washed away sickness.
Amen.
It washed away poverty. It washed away depression.
Come on with it.
And it gave you, it cleansed you inside and gave you the ability to house the Holy Spirit of God.
Amen.
The life of this body is in the understanding of the blood of Jesus. Amen. That we have entered into a covenant, that our bloods have intercommingled, and that we have become bone of his bone and flesh of his flesh. And when I speak, the creator of the universe speaks. Now, when you say I'm pretty high-minded, at least I'm not a barefoot pilgrim trudging through till one day I make heaven my home.
Amen.
At least I'm interested in helping other folks.
Amen.
When you say I'm pretty high-minded, I know who I am.
Amen.
And when the church realizes who they are, we can't be stopped.
Amen.
We won't grovel at the feet of bankers trying to help us fulfill our destiny.
Amen.
We won't have to mother may I the powers that be. Why? Because the love and the power of God will flow through this house. They will be bringing people by the dozens here to get healed,
Amen.
To get saved, and to get filled.
Amen.
We pastored one church in a place, and it seems I never asked for a certain type of people to come to the church, but they follow me around. I can't help it. And so they said, Jesus, you must be a drunkard and a glutton. He said, look, these folks follow me everywhere I go. I'm having a hard telling them to go home. I said, where are they going to go? Food stamps haven't hit. Come on, give them a break. And so we had a church in this one city, and the police chief came in. Yeah, everybody went, you remember that? When the chief came in, everybody went, I thought, well, it's either the deacon or the piano player. Somebody's gone today. But yeah, we're going to have an opening for something after this service. Well, he walked around, walked out. We got to talk later on. He said he heard about us. And he just wanted to see us. He had heard about it. And then he said this. He said, look, if I have somebody that I don't want to arrest, but I don't know what to do with them, can I bring them here to you?
Woo!
Amen.
That's church. That's what church should be. Not a bunch of people getting together, seeing who can dress the best, talk about each other.
Amen.
And nitpick each other for all our silly shortcomings. A place where the compassion of God should come up in fountains and waves.
Amen.
Healing for the body should be here. Do you understand?
Yes.
And so he said, in my name will you cast out devils in blood covenant. How many of you read where Jesus got baptized in the Jordan River and said, this is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased.
Amen.
In Jewish culture, it was just an indication to them. That's what a father did when the son took over the father's business. And he would say, this is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased, hear ye him. In other words, now when the son came and the son talked, it was just like the father talked.
Amen.
God was announcing to the world, when my boy talks, I'm talking, you better listen.
Amen.
And so Jesus, it says in Hebrews, is not ashamed to call me his brother. Which means that since I believed on him, he gave me the ability to become the son of the living God.
Amen.
So when I speak,
oh,
the Father
speaks.
When you speak, the Father speaks. If you don't like a situation in your life, tell it to stop.
Yes.
Amen.
And if
you're a problem, you fix yourself before you go nitpicking everybody else.
Amen.
And
so, he gave us power of eternity. He gave us the ability. Now listen, go to Acts 19. Some of you will like this. That's pretty heavy, so we'll give you a little moment to... You know, every now and then,
we like to
do a little religious doctrines here and there.
Amen.
Every now and then, not too often. I don't want to make everybody mad. Acts 19, 13. Now listen. How many of you look up here at me? How many of you have heard through the church world? Now, if the devil bothers you, all you got to say is the name of Jesus and it'll be okay. All of you have heard that? It's not true. It's not true, okay? What? Every time I come in here, you bust a bubble, you take away my songs. What is going on? Yeah, I've heard it through churches, you know. All you gotta do is say the name of Jesus and the devil will run. No, he won't. But if you understand blood covenant and what we've been teaching you, he will run in terror. The name of Jesus doesn't bother the devil at all. Let me show you. Some of you are like, oh, I don't believe that. Well, then let me give you a biblical account. Acts 19:13. It says, then certain of the vagabond Jews, exorcists, took upon them to call over them which had evil spirits the name of the Lord Jesus. Now they were saying the Lord Jesus' name, right? We adjure you by Jesus. There's that name Jesus whom Paul preaches. And there were seven sons, one Sceva, a Jew, and the chief priest, which did also. And the evil spirit answered and said, Jesus I know, Paul I know, but who are you?
Amen.
And the man in whom the evil spirit was leapt on them, overcame them, prevailed against them, so they fled out of that house naked and wounded. And see, religion and the devil by design has watered down the word of God. All you got to do is say Jesus. They tried it and they got beat country naked. See, if you don't know who Jesus is, what the blood's done, and who you are, the devil will beat you to death.
Amen.
You look like a spiritual pinball. Ding, 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 ding. Oh, Jesus, 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 Jesus. Ding, 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 ding. Pretty bad deal. Now listen, man, I haven't been whipped, but never that bad. My goodness, that's a bad deal. But when you understand this blood covenant that you and him are one, listen, understand that this will keep us from being a powerless church. And it'll keep you from begging and squalling at the altar for God to do something. And I don't have time to explain it, but really, God's done everything he's ever going to do.
Amen.
This is how I explain it to our church. And this little God's in control, we all hear, no, that's a load of garbage.
Yeah.
If he is in control, my God, I wish somebody had let him know because he's made a mess. My God, he's made a mess of this thing, hasn't he?
He did.
Amen. Yeah, but they say God's in control. Boy, he made a mess. And then he wants me to pray and struggle through. Boy, religion's hard. Well, I don't understand it. But understand this. You in the spirit realm look just like Jesus.
Amen.
That's right, amen.
Let's get on or we'll be here all day. Go to Colossians chapter 1. Colossians chapter 1. We'll wrap this up really quick. Yeah, right. I just say that so you keep thinking, see, he's almost done. Elijah said, this is really important, man. This will bring, if you understand this, this will bring a confidence to your Christianity in the prayer. At some point, you got to get tired of getting whipped country naked.
Amen.
And the only way to do that is to acquaint yourself with the Jesus. And now he said this. He said, Paul, I know. In other words, he said, I know this guy, Paul. He's got a relationship with Jesus.
Yes.
Yeah.
You've heard the name. You've heard about him.
Yeah.
But you really don't know who you are and what this thing's about. See, I'm here to enforce the victory that Jesus won. Now this is hard, a lot of the church world, this is hard for them to understand, but I am a visible representation of the invisible God on this earth.
Amen. Amen.
I am here to carry on the present day ministry of the Lord Jesus.
Amen. Amen.
I'm here to preach, teach, heal, cast out demons, and to bring something to the world.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Colossians chapter 1. I don't know which verse we were supposed to go to. 25?
Does that sound right?
125. Now here, Paul said this, whereof I am made a minister according to the dispensation of God, which is given to me for you to fulfill the word of God. Verse 26, even the mystery which had been hid from ages, from generations, but now is made manifest to his saints. And all of you here know, that garbage, God works in mysterious ways, is a big fat lie.
Amen. Amen.
Well, you know, God works in mysterious ways. You never know what he'll do, his mysteries to perform. God does not work in mysterious
right.
ways. Now, the things, how he causes his promises to come to pass may blow your mind, but he tells you every time what he's going to do if you do your part. What's the big mystery? Read the book.
Amen. Amen.
Read the book and the mystery is unveiled, right?
Yeah.
Now it said, to whom God would make known the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ. Everybody say Christ.
Christ.
Christ in you, the hope of glory. This is what the Father was saying. This is what the Holy Spirit was trying to say. That the whole mystery, the only mystery that was hidden, was for those who were under the law, who were spiritually dead, but that it was God's intention, listen, Christ in you. Remember Christ, the anointing of the anointed one. In other words, the ability of God, just like Jesus had inside of you.
That's right.
Amen.
He said this was the mystery that got hid from the ages till the church could be filled with the Holy Spirit. And he said, but this is what this whole thing was about from Genesis up till now, was that God could walk in you, live in you, move in you, that he could be your God, and we could again become his people.
Man.
Wow. And he said, the anointing of the anointed one in you. And then it says, the hope of glory. You could read it like this. Glory is God's presence that can be felt or manifested present. Hope is expectancy. And God said, here's what I want to see you understand. When we get born again and we're received into the family, we're restored to that place just like Adam and Eve. Do you understand?
Yes.
We can have an intimate relationship. We can walk with the Father in the cool of the day. We can get that close to him.
Yes.
And he said, now here's the whole mystery of the whole thing that's been hidden. That the anointing that I would put on my son would now rest in and on all of you.
Amen.
And that should cause an expectancy of my manifested presence to be among you wherever you are.
Amen.
Why? Because when these living stones get together, we are a holy temple fit for the master's use.
Amen.
Yes, amen.
And that's good.
Yes.
Aren't you glad I don't get up here and preach about sin every week?
Amen. Hallelujah.
Romans 12:3, it says this. It says, to every one of you among us, to every man among us, has been given the measure of faith. It doesn't say a measure of faith. It says, to every man among us has been given the measure of faith. Well, what's he talking about there? There are two things he's talking about there. Number one, every human being is born with the measure of faith. This measure of faith, the ability to believe that Jesus rose from the dead.
Amen.
And then, once you are born again, every one of you have the measure of faith. What is that? The faith of the Son of God. Mm-hmm. Let me say, once this hit, man, they got to be excited.
No doubt.
You have been given the measure of faith. What does that mean? to Jesus now belongs to you.
Praise God.
Wow.
See, all the churches tell you, yes, Jesus lives in me. Really, he doesn't. You see it at the right hand of God. But the Spirit of God dwells in you. Yes, it's in you. The Spirit, the Holy Spirit's in me. So that means that I have the faith of the Son of God, according to Galatians 2:20.
Right.
Amen.
Yes.
See, I have been given the measure of faith. What is that? The ability to believe that blind eyes can open, deaf ears can hear,
Amen.
The dead can be raised, the devil's got to leave when we come in a room.
Amen. Yeah. Amen.
I've been given that measure of faith.
Yes.
Well, I'm not there yet. Saying. You don't know who you are yet.
Amen.
See, you are as much a son of God as the original son of God.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah, you might have done some bonehead things, but you're still the son of God. You still have the same rights and privileges. It says we, as sons and daughters of God, are now seated at his right hand in Christ Jesus. In other words, there is no distinction between us and him.
Amen.
There is no Jesus way up here and you way down here. It is us together. You can't tell where he begins and I end and where I end and he begins.
Hallelujah.
That's the beauty of blood covenant. Listen, let me let you in on this just to break some molds down out of your thinking. Jesus did not get a different Holy Ghost than you got. You didn't get the marked down basement version of the Holy Ghost. Well, Jesus can open blind eyes and heal the sick, but I got that A to Z Holy Ghost. Must have been a little stoked about 3 years ago.
It only opened one eye.
Guess the one I got expired 3 years ago. You were given, 2 Corinthians says that we, well, let's look at that, and then we'll major on here. Go to 2 Corinthians 4, I want to show you something. Not bad so far. When you're ready to go, wave at me. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, I'm trying to go as quick as I can.
The A to Z.
2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 11. It says, for we which live are always delivered unto death for Jesus' sake, that the life also of Jesus might... Now listen, this, we just read this thing. This is truth. How many of you believe this is truth?
Yes.
All right. Man, my God. That the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our mortal flesh.
Praise God.
You like that, don't you?
Yeah.
That's good stuff.
We're going to walk on water.
So then death works in us, but life in you. Now verse 13, we having the same spirit of faith. Same spirit of faith as what? As Jesus. Why, one of my confessions is that though I may pass on into death, that this mortal body will put on immortality and I will rise from the grave.
Amen.
And I will be called home.
Amen.
See, I believe, therefore I speak. Jesus said, lay me down, but I'm going to stay 3 days. It's hard to keep a God man down.
Amen.
You understand? You can knock me down, you can beat me, you can kill me, but I only got 3 days of laying down in me. I got stuff.
That's what's up.
And we, having the same spirit of faith, we believe, therefore we speak.
Amen.
Oh, glory to God.
If you want to know where your heart is or somebody else, listen to their words.
Amen. Amen.
And then it says this, I believed and therefore have I spoken. We also believe and therefore we speak. Isn't that good stuff?
Amen.
Romans 8:11 says this. It says the same spirit that raised
Christ,
the anointed one from the dead.
Now
dwells in your mortal body. Remember, you didn't get the always saved version of the Holy Ghost. Huh? You didn't get the best choice Holy Ghost. Sam's choice Holy Ghost. You got the God of the universe just like Jesus Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Even that's dangerous preaching like that. It sure is, devil, because we're coming for you.
Amen.
It's real dangerous to preach like this. Listen, you can't tell me there's nothing I can't do.
That's right.
See, the devil might knock me down. I might be sleeping in the back of a car tomorrow, but rest assured, I'll have a church in
that's
a few
right.
months.
That's right.
I will change a city. Why? Because I know, I believe, therefore I have spoken. The same spirit that raised Christ from the dead and now dwells in my mortal body. I don't believe that I can't.
Amen.
I don't believe that I can't. And when you get to that point, we can change this world.
Amen.
You know, the limitless God lives in you.
The limitless God.
The only limits that God has in your life is those that you put on Him.
That we put on Him. Amen.
The Bible says in Ephesians 3:20, now unto Him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that I could ever ask or think, according to the power that works in us. One translation says that He can do exceedingly abundantly above all that you ask, think, dream, or even dare to imagine.
Wow.
That's right, man.
I like that.
And I got good imagination.
think about some of those animals we got, man. Wild imagination. And God said, if you figure out this blood covenant, and that the same Holy Ghost that was in my original son is in you now. That same power that raised Christ from the dead, man, that is now in the mortal body, that in John 14:12, when He told you the words, I do, you can do it even greater. Yeah. If you will just believe that. But you have been trained that God's a God of maybe. Maybe He doesn't will it today. Well, that's a little too far-fetched. That's too hard to believe. Listen. God has made some outstanding promises in the Word of God. That's why it's called faith.
Yes. Amen.
You have to believe that if God said you can walk on nothing, that you can walk on nothing and have everything.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
That's what faith's about. Now go to 1 John. I promise we're almost done. 1 John. Now, this is one, if you didn't come up in a church like this, that you probably haven't heard much in the church world. 1 John chapter 4, verse 16.
1 John or John?
1 John. Down by Revelation. Let's start in verse 15. Let's start in verse 14. 1 John 4:14. And we have seen and do testify that the Father sent the Son to be Savior of the world. That's good news.
Amen.
And whosoever shall confess that Jesus is the Son of God. Now listen, God dwelleth in him and he in God. Think about that for a second. Whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God, God dwells in him and him in God.
Amen.
Did the Word just say God lived in you?
Yes.
Well, I don't know if I can do that. I don't know if that'll come to pass. I just don't know what I'm going to do. Then that tells me you haven't spent time with God.
Yes.
Yeah. Wow. If you say Jesus raised from the dead, God dwells in you. This is where on 29:11 to renew your mind. God dwells in you. This is not just about going to heaven when you die if you don't chew tobacco. This is about the Creator of the universe possessing your human vessel and explosions of heaven to go wherever you go. That's what this thing's about.
Amen.
Is that, and we have known and believed the love of God that God hath to us. God is love. And he that dwelleth in love dwells in God and God in him. Verse 17. Now this is going to blow you away. Okay. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment. Now look at this. Because as he is, so are we in this world.
Amen.
Well, two of you go change the world.
Yeah.
The rest of you go watch Dennis and Franklin on cable. I don't know. Listen, let me read this again. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness. We can have boldness in the New Testament church.
Yes.
When I pray for people for healing, I don't tell them, maybe something will happen. I tell them, when I lay hands on you, God will heal you.
Amen.
Why? Because I got that boldness. Because I understand that I am in blood covenant. Whatever he promised, he can't lie. And if he said, I lay hands on the sick and they recover, when I lay hands on the sick, they recover. I don't believe that I can fail.
Amen.
And moreover, I don't believe that God can fail, the love of God, or the promises of God.
That's right. Amen.
By blood covenant, we have become one.
Yes. Amen.
Remember, David Livingston, he carried that big spear. We carry the mark of a spear in the spirit realm in our side.
Amen.
And Satan says, dear God, who is that? Is that that Jesus fella again? I don't want none of that. I don't want any of that. I've had that. That's no good for me. Verse 17, herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world.
Yes, amen.
Chew on that a minute. Let that knock around your noggin for a while. As he is, so are we in this world. What does that mean for the body of Christ? What does that mean for you? That means that you are healing.
Come on.
Because as he is, so are we in this world. Mark 16 said, whatever he said I can do, right?
Amen.
We make our confession and do our little word. This is the word. I have what it says I can have. John Osteen started a long time ago. But when we get down to brass tacks, as he is in this world, so are we. What does that mean? By right of blood covenant, you are healing wherever you go.
Amen.
You are hope to the hopeless wherever you go. You are help for the helpless wherever you go.
Amen.
You are clothes for the naked. You are food for the hungry. You are the answer of the world wherever you go. There God is.
Amen.
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 Amen. Oh, my God.
Woo!
Because as he is, as he is, I am in this world.
That's right. That's what's up.
That you've been given the mind of Christ, whatever situation you find yourself in, you have the ability to understand and access the plan and the will of
God. Amen.
Well, I don't know what I'm going to do. As he is in this world, so are we. You know what I've never heard God say? A few things. I never heard him say, I don't know what I'm going to do this time, Dave. Got any plans? Got any ideas? Never heard God say that. He's never asked me for his input. But see, that's the beauty of blood covenant. As he is in this world, so are we. What is he saying? In this world, you're just like me. Remember, God became flesh. So the representation we have of God in this world, like we are, is Jesus, the Messiah.
Amen.
And so he's saying, just like the Messiah, in this world, so are you. Just like the Messiah in this world, so are you.
Right.
Right? The Bible says, if I believe he raised from the dead, God dwells in me.
Man.
That's right. And here's what I learned. God's so big, I'm kind of a little guy. Sometimes he squeezes out of me. Things get old, folks. You understand? That's why Peter, when he walked, his shadow, when he walked by, his shadow passed on, they got healed. Why? Because God's so big to contain in this human vessel, he kind of just squoze out all over him.
Yes.
The anointing of God emanated from him. Why? Because he understood that I am the Father of one, and that I am in the same standing, and the same rank, and the same ability as Jesus the Christ.
Amen.
Since he was the anointed one and I am a Christian and I'm just like the anointed one, there is nothing he did that I can't do because of blood covenant.
Amen.
And if there's something he can do that I can't, then God lied and let's all go get drunk today. Amen.
Amen.
I mean, you got to get this center. Either this thing is 100% true or we can explain parts of it away. If we can explain parts of it away, I want to go back to my old life. Because there is no hope for me anywhere else.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Well, I don't know about that, David. That's pretty far. Keep rolling around.
Right.
It'll take years and years, man. Sometimes days, sometimes minutes to get this into you. That's why at this church we don't pray, God be with us. We say, thank you, God, you are here.
Amen.
There's Because all of us know that when you walked in, the creator of the universe walked in with you.
Yes, amen.
Oh, God, be with them. Now, thank you, God, you are with them.
Amen.
I don't understand churches praying for the Holy Spirit to come down either. He already did that. He came down.
Amen.
Amen.
God, send your spirit down. Done. Next. And I see them at the altar. Shut up. God, send your spirit down. I thought, again? No, we should just be learning who we are in Christ and allowing what's in us to erupt like a volcano.
Amen.
Yeah. That's what we should do.
Amen.
Let me read one thing out of the message. One thing out of the message, and I'll let you go, okay?
And
how many times have I told you that? Still going. That's why I got 1 John 1:9. If I was quick to confess my sin in my life, simple answer. Romans chapter 8, verse 15, okay? The Message Bible. Promise you this is the last one. It says, the resurrection life you receive from God. Now I like this. Let me read it again. So the resurrection life you receive from God is not a timid, grave-tending life. What does that mean? It means that you were not born again and filled with the Holy Ghost to wait to die.
That's right.
Amen. You were not saved to wait to die, and that's what most churches give you hope for. One day when you die, it'll be better. I'm telling you, from blood covenant, from the standing of blood covenant. This is not a timid, brave, tending life. 50 Cent said this. He said, I got a whole lot of living to do before I die.
That's right.
I said, well, who's... Romans 8, verse 15. Or verse, 15. Said, the Message Bible said it is not a timid, brave, tending life. Although death is going to be glorious, I ain't trying to die, man. I'm trying to live.
Yeah. Amen. Amen.
Why, in my living, Jesus is alive on this earth.
Right. Amen.
In my living, the dregs of society come to find love and compassion and understanding.
Yes.
Most churches, your only hope is waiting to die. Here's what they should do then at those churches. Have this big thing like a sideways toilet. When they baptize them, hold them under until they quit kicking and suck them out. Think, man. You know, if my only hope is dying, you understand? If my only hope is dying, hold me under and let me go.
Amen.
But no, it's not a timid, grave-tending life. It is now a shepherd boy and a giant.
Amen.
Do you understand? It's me facing Goliath now in the power of the covenant.
Amen.
Saying, is that all you got?
Amen.
Is that all you got? And see, when you understand, he says, the same spirit that raised Christ from the dead now dwells in your mortal body. Listen, it says, not a grave-tending life. It's adventurously expectant. Is your life adventurously expectant? Or is it full of gloom and doom and poor little me? If your life is not gloriously, adventurously expectant, you should wake up in the morning and say, what are we doing today?
Amen.
Now, what have you got for me today? What's the plan, man? It should be adventurously expectant. Greeting God with childlike, what's next, Papa?
Amen.
That's good. Amen.
God's Spirit Woo! Touches our spirit and confirms who we really are. It's not what religion told you you were, not what your mom and dad and friends and family and police and psychiatrist, but His Spirit confirms who we really are.
Amen.
I remember the day His Spirit touched my spirit, and I realized I was only born to preach the Word of God. I'm none of those things they label me. Man, before the foundations of the world, I was ordained to be a pastor and a preacher and the bringer of the gospel. His Spirit confirms who we really are. We know who He is. We know who we are, Father and children. That's beautiful. And we know we're going to get what's coming to us, an unbelievable inheritance. We go through exactly what Christ goes through. If we go through the hard times with him, then we're certainly going to go through the good times with him. How do you go through the hard times to get to the good times?
Amen.
Understanding.
Oh, that's good news.
Greater is he that's in me than he that's in this world.
Amen.
Greater is he that's in me than he that's in this world. Listen, I'll leave you with this thought. Did we just find out that God's in us?
Amen.
That the same spirit that was in Jesus is also in you because of blood covenant. And what Jesus did, you can do. And then he said even greater than thee. Well then you think about this the next time life's getting you down. Or the next time you think this little body of believers can't accomplish what I tell you we want to do. The power that's in you is the power that caused the earth to appear and to swing on its axis.
Amen. Amen.
Whoa.
It's the power that split the Red Sea when the Egyptians were pursuing the Israelites.
Yeah.
It's the power that caused the sun to stand still when Joshua had to keep fighting.
Amen.
That's pretty powerful stuff, isn't it?
Amen.
And that's just parts of it. It's the power that invaded the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea, invaded hell, death, and the grave, and brought our Savior to life. That's in you.
Amen.
See, don't get shackled to the shell that houses the Spirit of God. That's real you.
Amen.
The real you is pure, righteous, holy, and powerful, and able to overcome anything. It says of Joseph and Caleb and Joshua and Caleb in the Bible that some of them went and saw the giant and said, we don't know what we're going to do. Well, God had already said that the land was theirs. He said, this is yours. You can have it. They went and looked and said, but there's big fellas over there. We're scared.
Right.
And Joshua and Caleb said, I don't sweat that. God said, it's mine. It's mine. Let's go get it.
Amen.
The Bible says they were of a different spirit.
Amen.
And for you to have what God says you can have, to do what God says you can do, and to be what God said you can be, you're going to have to get of a different spirit.
Amen.
And get this in your mouth. I am well able to overcome. Remember, through Christ, through Christ, through Christ. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty through God. I'm in blood covenant.
Amen.
And I hold his spear in the spirit realm. Amen.
Amen.
Father, we just thank you. We thank you today. That God, whatever.